Okay, here I am in Barranquilla, Colombia. Like I mentioned to many of my students, I came here for a congress, a conference at La Universidad del Norte. Here we are at the most important river in Colombia. This actually empties into the Caribe. It's called like the Mississippi of Colombia. It goes through the whole entire country. One of the things I wanted to talk about right now, which you're going to be reading about, etc., is the Venezuela migration problem. Venezuela right now is going through a crisis of just titanic proportions, no pun intended, because I'm right here on the river. But the point is, here in Barranquilla, they're absorbing tens of thousands of Venezuelans. They're saying every month, because we're right near the border with Venezuela over there. Now, I'm obviously not going to start filming where they live, etc. You will see a video from Bogota, how they're eking out a living. But here outside the capital city, in kind of although this is an industrialized port city to a certain degree, although a lot poorer than Bogota, they're living in horrible, squalid conditions, and the border's just hours away right over there. So Colombia doesn't know what to do. Why is this important, particularly for the class? Well, number one, migration is a huge issue, not just in between Colombia and Venezuela, but you look at the Syrian refugees, what happened obviously in Iraq, what's going on in Myanmar, etc., is that what kind of policies can we develop through IGOs, NGOs, and state behavior, non-state behavior, actors, in order to alleviate the suffering of these people. Venezuela is going through a titanic crisis right now. Now, obviously, the Trump administration attributes the crisis to Maduro. If you hate the President Maduro, they attribute it to him, but Maduro will attribute it to the sanctions and other variables. But remember, Venezuela has gone through huge booms and busts attributable to oil prices. Under the president of Hugo Chavez, the economy was actually doing well for three reasons. Number one, the oil. Number two, banking was doing extremely well in Latin America at the time. And the other pillar of the Venezuelan economy is construction. And Hugo Chavez was using the money, oil at the time, to build houses, etc. So the economy was actually doing well. He's actually continues to be one of the most popular, even though he's dead, politicians in Venezuela. But Venezuela now is horrible. And Maduro has run two times to be the president, one against a man named Enrique Capriles, and then second against a man named Falcon. This has been quite horrible to have the continuation. Basically, they changed the constitution so he can continue running, and then he suspended the Congress, that is President Maduro of Venezuela. When Juan Guaido came up, he was seen as like a hero, he's gonna change everything, but he actually failed, which I predicted. Maduro has done what I call the Egyptianization of Venezuela. That's basically the idea that the military has taken over key posts and economic ministries, and it's giving them, that is the military, public goods. So basically the military is still supporting Maduro, although his ratings, that is in the polls, are 12% approval ratings. You know, will he be overthrown? What will happen? But how do we basically address also this crisis in Venezuela? Even if Maduro leaves, the booms and busts of what we call the resource curse, that is when an economy depends too heavily on a natural resource like petroleum, it's very, very bad. And also it suffers what we call Dutch disease. Dutch disease is a problem, a phenomena where all the money, all the capital starts going into the oil industry, and you have deindustrialization. And as well, the inflation takes hold. The currency, because it's demanded on the international market, becomes too inflated, and your exports, you basically have to import everything and you export very little. And this has happened to Venezuela. Remember, this is not the first crisis in Venezuelan history. It has gone through these booms and busts. Another was 1989 with Caracaso, when Carlos Andres Perez basically killed, with the help of the United States, with the support, up to 3,000 innocent Venezuelans, according to NGOs and other data. So we weren't really supporting democracy back then. We still aren't now. We say we're supporting Juan Guaido, a man who's against Maduro, and then Russia and China are supporting basically Maduro. But who is the legitimate president? I don't think any of these powers care about democracy in Venezuela. I think they just care about allies. So right now I'm here in Colombia. Colombia has had huge problems with human rights. In fact, the New York Times reporter just fled the country because basically for his life, because he wrote about corruption in the Colombian military. Why don't we put sanctions on Colombia? Moreover, the president, who President Trump supports now, of Ecuador, has just made protests illegal in Ecuador, Lenin Moreno. Why don't we put sanctions on them? So this isn't a question about democracy. This is probably a question of just getting allies in a more multipolar world. So China and Russia see an ally in Venezuela. We see an ally in Colombia, in Ecuador, etc. What is going to happen, though, to the real people being hurt by all these problems, regardless of whether you hate the government of Venezuela? Well, very few like the government of Venezuela right now. Maduro is not popular. But, you know, with this crisis of immigration, what are we going to do? Do we, you know, send in the United Nations? Do we set up more refugee camps? You know, Colombia has absorbed a lot, but there's a lot now of what we call xenophobia against the Venezuelans that are coming into Colombia. And we have other dictatorial measures within the other Latin American countries, like Colombia, like Ecuador, I just said, making protests illegal, and now Bolsonaro in Brazil. So, and the president of Peru just suspended the Congress in Peru. So, I mean, we don't know what's going on in Latin America, but there seems to be crises taking hold. Honduras, obviously, we had the caravan. Honduras is ruled, in my opinion, by a horrible dictator. But here we are in Barranquilla, Colombia, doing research. It's very interesting. I just gave a conference at Universidad del Norte, and it went over, well, I think pretty well, even though I'm sure some people disagreed by their expressions. But again, as I leave you, this is the Magdalena. This goes right into Caribe, where I'm going later, as we're going to go towards the border and other places. It's not completely safe, so I don't want to go, you know, into too sketchy areas. But if Teddy, you want to show the Magdalena, this is the Magdalena, the boat. Look at it, very important for the economy of Colombia. Barranquilla is an industrialized city, and this is the new port. Very, very beautiful area. They're trying to construct it, get some tourism in, obviously, because of the FARC, the negotiations that Santos, the former president of Colombia, did. They're trying to now change the face of Colombia, but some ex-FARC members, that's the guerrilla group, have gone back to fighting. So this is another struggle that Latin America and Colombia has. So not only does it have this wave of millions of Venezuelans because of the crisis in Venezuela, but also it has to deal with, you know, new guerrilla groups popping up when it thought it actually solved with the peace crisis. So there's a lot going on here. I hope you enjoyed this little lecture here from Barranquilla, Colombia, and the Magdalena. Look at, we got some fishermen over here. They're basically saying, what the hell is this gringo doing here filming us? He's probably in the CIA, the CIA. But anyways, we'll talk to you. If you have any questions, just email me, etc. Thanks so much. Yeah, fiend.